Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity and inviting me to address the academicians who by profession today are much needed to make a transformation in India, especially when the country is eyeing to have a 5 trillion economy and there's a lot that is expected out of the education community to help the nation. I'm also thankful to the chair here who has given me this opportunity to come and speak. I was going through the letter that was sent to me. It talked about the cooperatives and I thought, let me glance through about this cooperative movement in India. I had never gone through in detail about the cooperative movement in India, but because I was invited for this event, so I thought, let me have a look at it. And then some literature which was lying on the table. To my surprise, I found in one of the documents mentioning 300 top cooperatives in the world, in one of the documents that's on my table. And I was wondering that India being one of the largest economies and having such a 1.2 billion population and almost 70% in the rural areas would have definitely done something miraculous when it comes to cooperatives. And to my shock, I found out of 300 listed companies in the sheet, only 3 companies mentioned as the among the top 300 cooperatives. And I found IFCO, Gujarat Cooperative and Cribco highlighted in that. Then I thought, let me have a look at what is the turnover of these companies. Maybe I am missing something on the turnover. And to my surprise, I found the companies that are on the topmost turnover, $90 billion, $70 billion, $80 billion are consistently in double digits. And all of these companies are either from the France or from Germany or Switzerland or USA, Poland. And when I looked at the cooperatives in India, I think IFCO has been mentioned with $4 billion turnover, Cribco is $1 billion and Gujarat Milk Federation is somewhere around $2.5 billion. And I am surprised. And surprised why? Because cooperatives, as mentioned in some of the literature that it started in 1904, to me, cooperatives has been the backbone of India for many, many millennia. I don't think cooperatives just started because Britishers had to bring in some law and act and then the cooperatives started in India. In fact, I was recalling when I had read this Arthashastra by Chanakya. He has mentioned many cooperatives in his Arthashastra. And fortunately, I recalled what I had read in Rig Veda some months back. It did not mention specifically about the cooperative, but it mentioned certain shlokas which talked about the group activities, the activities of unison that are being performed in the society. And then it reminded me that in the Indian context, we used to have Gram, Kula, Shreni, and they were the representatives of the cooperatives of our own times. The Kula was the smallest form of a cooperative in India. Then the Gram, then the Shreni. This is how the entire cooperative system in the India was established, without giving it the name of the Act, Cooperative Act in the country. But anyway, I think somewhere we have lost our legacy. Somewhere we have lost the strength that this country had. And it gives me no word to mince, because when I reflect back on the history of India and the Indian education system, I'm not surprised. I don't know how many of you have read one of the most famous economists and his report. His name was Angus Madison. He was engaged by Britishers to conduct an economic study of the world. And when Angus Madison started his work, he decided that okay, he will conduct a study, and his timeline started from 1 century AD. So, to cut it short, if you read Angus Madison's study report, it says from 1 century AD until 17th, 18th century, which economies in the world, which countries in the world had the highest share in the GDP of the world? You will be surprised. He mentions in his report that in 1 century AD, India's contribution to the GDP was 33%. And India and China combined was more than 52-53%. Means India was the major contributor to the global GDP. Now, GDP means what? Gross domestic product is the aggregate outcome of your products, services that you produce, which means that by 1st century AD, if it was 33%, that means the contribution production services that India made at that time was phenomenal. If we go with that, and even if you go behind that 180 timeline to the Harappan and the previous civilization, you will be surprised that the major economy that India contributed to the world, and the contribution of India, was the metal. Right from the Kaveri Basin to the Caspian Sea, this is where India would ship it to the entire world. India knew how to mix the many metals and create bronze and copper. And the evidences were available in Harappan and Mohenjo-Daro civilizations. So, I am not going back to that, because then the debate goes to something else, but I am going to what Angus Madison has mentioned in 1 century AD, and it is an authentic report. It is not a report by an Indian. So, if 1 century AD India was having 33-34% of GDP, what was India doing at that time? What was happening in India? So, I sometimes, you know, I try to look at what was happening in India. You will be surprised that the educational institutions in India was the backbone of its strength. Today, you talk about the Harvard, Stanford, London Business School, Oxford. My dear friends, India had the best of its Oxfords and Harvards and London Business Schools at that time. If you go and read the educational history of India, you will be surprised to see that institutions of great repute, Takshila, Nalanda, Sonapura, Udhantapuri, Kanthanur Shala, Vallabhi, and many, many more. No, I can keep on talking about the names. The mathas, the temples, they were called the temple universities. Hundreds of these institutions. And what did they do? They produced the extremely intelligent scholars. And if you go and start writing the names of the scholars, you will have to spend almost a month on collating the names of the scholars. And what did these scholars do? They had phenomenal inventions, innovations, and in every field, whether astronomy, astrology, metallurgy, healthcare, making bridges, or any of the areas, you pick up any, textiles, cloth making, jewelry, you know, in Germany, I was surprised when some years back I traveled there, they had a department there called charcology. So I was intrigued to ask them, what is this charcology department? You will be surprised. They said, this is in the name of Maharishi Charak. And they have named it as charcology department. They believe that the entire science of healthcare has actually come from Maharishi Charak Samhita, and they have put a lot of research around it. They call it the natural healthcare system, and there is a lot of research going on in Germany. In Melbourne, they have installed the idol of one of the greatest scientists of old days, which they called the father of surgery, Sushupta. There is a Sushupta idol installed in the Melbourne University, and at the entry you will find, and they have captioned it with father of modern surgery. And it's not untrue. You go and read the Sushupta Samhita. Similarly, there are doctrines around many things. And these doctrines actually resulted into so many inventions, so many creations, so many products, so many services. And this is because the creation, invention, innovation, contribution and export of these services actually created interest in the world scholars to come and see what's happening in India. Which is this place? What is this place called? What are they doing there? So different. And then it prompted thousands of people, scholars, to come to India. Many couldn't reach because those days there were no helicopter services and bus services. Even the Tongas were not available. So they had to walk thousands of kilometers, and you have so many scholars writing, whether it is Hyun Sang, Fahian, they're writing about it. And those who were lucky to reach India, they spent many years in India and moved from one institution to another institution to find and get surprised that how they are managing this vast education system. And the foundation of that education system, you know, I remember one quote in Rig Veda. It says that let the noble thoughts come from all sides. Krintova yantu vishvataha aryam. It says, let the noble thoughts come. This is the fundamental principle of Rig Veda. It meant that you can even welcome the contrarian view. And that was the reason why you had so many doctrines and so many philosophies and so many thoughts, so many practices emerging in India. Because you let every idea to incubate. So, I sometimes feel surprised, what happened? What happened to us? But then when you read the history and when you read the medieval period after 12th century, we became a little accessible to international world, and then the story, you had invaders coming in, and then you had the country becoming a part of the British colony, and then the British had done the biggest damage, which most of you would be familiar with. So the first thing is, somewhere we lost something, and what we lost something was the strength of our education system, the strength of our teaching pedagogy, the way our gurukuls taught. See, cooperative movement is not new to India. What is cooperative? I was asked, what is cooperative? Cooperative is what? Where a group of people come together and they learn together in a more collaborative manner. And today in the modern world, we call it work-enabled learning. You integrate the experience into the teaching. But unfortunately, the biggest problem today that we are facing when we look at the current scenario, see, we produce more than 15 lakh engineers every year. 1.5 million engineers we are producing every year. But almost 70%, 80% of these engineers are unemployable. Why are they unemployable? The reason for their unemployability is because the three core institutions, educator, educatee, and the employer, are living in three different worlds. The demand of the employer is not aligned by the method of the educator. And then the educatee is also coming from a different perspective. They think that going to a college or a university is just to spend 2-3 hours and to get a degree. And even the faculty also thinks, once I have got a job, no one can take me out from this job. So my job is to come, open the book, start writing on the board, and my job is over. And the industry is thinking, I don't need both of them. If you go and ask any industry today, would you want to partner with any institution? They say, thank you very much. Because they are also going through a terrible pressure of productivity and profitability. They have to maintain their productivity and profitability. But for productivity and profitability, they need talent. Talent was expected to be produced from the institutions. Institutions have failed in their outcome. So what is happening? Most of the corporates today are opening their own institutions. If you are not aware, many of the big corporates, what they are doing, when they hire engineers from the market, they take them to their own institution. Infosys, Schneider, IBM, Wipro, Tata, they have opened their own campus colleges where they hire graduate engineers, then they train them for 1 year. Now imagine the training that they give them in the 1 year campus that was supposed to be given in the academic campus. Isn't it a big loss to them? It's a big loss to nation. It's a loss to the student who has wasted 1 year. So when you have been brought into this academic training, I'm not getting because policy and other things I was looking at, you will be taken through all that, I'm sure you have the fact. I am only concerned about one thing. And this is one thing which I tell my own faculty when my teachers come in, that do not enter into the class without realizing what you have to deliver. And today's delivery mode, method has changed. Because unless you know the output, and output means what? Output means what actually that must add as a value. If you think your student has passed the examination and taken a degree and that was the output, you are miserably mistaken. There are millions of people holding a degree and a master's in their hand, but the qualification value is zero. So if that is the outcome you are looking, that is not what I am indicating about. A faculty must recognize that whatever I produce in the class, what is the value this person is going to add in the society, whether in an industry. Now for that, you need to understand what kind of services it need to work upon. So have you mapped reverse? What are the market needs? What are the market trends? What are the market expectations? What are the market challenges? What has changed in the market? Many of the students, when I interact with them in industry, they have been taught in their engineering colleges about the lathe machines. They have practiced on the lathe machines, and when they enter into the industry, there are no lathe machines. There is no work which is supposed to be done on the lathe machines. So the time they spend, the credits they earn on the lathe machine work has been wasted. Similarly, there are many job roles today where students are taught because it is mentioned in the curriculum, and no one has ever bothered, no faculty has ever bothered, even if you have to deliver this curriculum, how should this curriculum be delivered in line with the changes in the market? changes in the environment. And let me tell you, there are drastic changes going around in the market. The emergence of 4.0 technology, which includes IoT, which includes machine learning, cloud computing, artificial intelligence, has disrupted everything. And today, in smallest of the jobs, including your agriculture, dairy farming, the IoT and artificial intelligence are creating so much of disruption that if the students or the ones who want to get into the mode of doing some work, if they are not aligned with those changed technologies, they will fail. The another challenge today, when I was reading through this, I think one of the biggest problems today is the leadership qualities among the people who become the members of these cooperatives. So students whom you teach, and when they tomorrow become a member of a cooperative, what are those changing leadership traits that are required? Now, one is you teach them that, see, these are the four characteristics of leaders. This is not what is required today. Remember, the learning styles of the new generation has also changed. Today, you go and many of you would be married and you would have children. Have you ever interacted with your children? 90% times, if you start telling your children to do something, which is called the direct style. You know, there's a directive style where I tell you what to do. 90% of the time, children will react. If they are fearful to react, they would have already closed their ears. Because the learning style of the new millennia has changed. There was a time when we were in the class. No, I'm not as old as you think. But when I was in my classes, we were dependent on library and the teacher coming in the class. Either we will go to the library and then we will have to keep silence, take a book, read it, or go out of the library, or wait for the lecturer. Now today, student doesn't wait for the lecture. And I'll tell you why he doesn't wait for the lecture. Because what you are going to teach on the board, it is already available to him. He has a free access to it. He can open the Google. I'll tell you, when I came from my office to this place today, I was asking him, what is my class today? He said, this is the cooperative. I said, okay. So no preparation. So I immediately opened the Google and started. It took me 30 minutes by the time I reached this place. What should I talk about? Our students are even smarter. They know better than all of us how to use the social media. So direct style of teaching will not work with the new generation. There is another style, that is discuss style. Now, discuss style means you will have to engage the student, but for discuss style, the teacher himself has to be prepared. What will you make student to discuss? So, which means a teacher should have understood the challenges, intricacies, complexities, differences, opportunities, and converted them into some kind of small caselets, some kind of small role plays, some kind of small simulations in the class, and then make the students discuss. Now, if you become a teacher in discussion, you will not be liked. Many teachers still can't leave their teaching syndrome. Teacher syndrome hota na? No, I have to hold the stick in the hand and you should be, hey, hello, you do this. No, you have to leave the hat of a teacher and take the hat of a facilitator. There's a difference between teacher and a facilitator. Students must be given this impression that they are the center of knowledge. They know it. We trust and we respect their knowledge. That's what IITs used to do. IIT would give you a case study in the evening. You go home, it's your responsibility to study it. And next day morning, we only will facilitate the discussion. So the onus of learning is passed on. Accountability of learning is with the student, not with the teacher. Teacher has to prepare. Yes. If the teacher goes unprepared in the class, it will fail, it will crash. So the second part, that the second D discuss, is very critical. The third D, which is even more critical and more impactful, is discover. Now in discover, when you feel the student has gained a level of understanding about the issues, you create some projects for the students and ask them to go and do. They are not supposed to be in the class. Individually, in groups, they must go and start exploring and finding and start reaching out to the masses or the market or the industry or the area. Let them find out. Let them go on the ground and figure out. So, what I feel that as a faculty, when I'm not going to tell you what you should be teaching, that's, you are the masters of your area, but I am very, very keen to tell you that remember who is your audience, who are these people? They are the new generation millennials. Also in your classes you may have challenges because some students would be at one level, some students would be at another level. So that is where you also have to be very agile. A teacher's role is very critical, very critical, very important in transforming these groups into productive. And at the end, let me tell you, if you are a teacher and in your lifetime you teach say 2000 students, and imagine when you are at the retirement, how would you want to see yourself and your performance? What did you produce? Someone asked me someday, if you have to write your own obituary, how will you write that? If I have, or you have to write your own obituary, how should you want to be remembered when you are not there by the people around you? So as a faculty, you must also remember, how should you be remembered? Will you be remembered you made 50 people to pass the exam? Or will you be remembered that you made the lives of 50 people who transformed the lives of 5,000 people?